So, good afternoon all. So, are you enjoying the conference so far? Yeah. Yay! So, today I'm going to tell you something about tracing your services with the help of SLUS, Sipkin and the Elk Stack. So, my name is Rafaela. I'm working at Lumens Amsterdam. I like to solve problems with creative solutions, and I also like to use existing solutions to solve my problems. I like to use Spring and Spring Boot, and I also like to travel and to take pictures, and I like to combine those two as well. So for today, let's just imagine that we are starting at a new company, and that new company needs a new application. And this new application needs to create a breakfast for us. So, well, we have several teams, and we are just thinking of what we are going to do, and we decide to use microservices, and we also decide to use Spring Boot, and we are also going to use the Elk Stack for our loggings, and we are also using Cucumber for our end-to-end tests and, well, Selenium as well. And we are starting developing and also deploying the application, bringing it to production. And everything works fine until there's someone coming at your desk. And he tells you that the application is not working anymore. So, of course, we are asking what is exactly not working. And he tells you that the application is being slow. So, of course, we are asking what is exactly being slow. And he tells you that when he pushes the toast button, it takes more than 5 seconds to get the results. So, of course, we can believe him, but we are going to try that out ourselves. So, here we have our toaster, and we are going to push that button. And, well, it's taking quite some time. And now our bread is burnt. So it's taking too long. So what do we know? Well, we decided to use microservices. So our structure consists of this. So when we push the toast button, we have the breakfast service, and the breakfast service is calling several other services, and the toast service is calling other services as well. So we have this structure, but and somewhere in one of those services, or maybe multiple services, there's something going wrong, something making it very slow. So we want to know what is exactly going wrong, of course. So the first thing we are going to do is take a look at our logs. So each application is spitting out the logs, but well, because there are several applications, and we want to ensure that the results are merged, we are using the Elk Stack. So what is the Elk Stack? It consists of Elasticsearch, Logstash, and Kibana. And when a log message of an application is spitted out, it will be sent over UDP to Logstash. Logstash will collect the log message, we'll split it in several fields, for example, the log level, the date, the log message itself, or maybe the exception. And it will put it into our data store, namely Elasticsearch. Next, there is Kibana. And Kibana is a user interface you can use to take a look at which data is stored in your Elasticsearch data store. So this is an example of the Kibana user interface. On top you can search, just, and here you can filter. So you can filter on a specific field, for example, the application name or something, and you can put a value right there. You can select fields you want to take a look at, and here are your actual log messages. So all of our microservices are having the log messages into the same interface right here. So you can take a look at each of the microservices. So it's easy to search your loggings and to filter with the Elk Stack. But, well, we are not any further in finding our slow performance. So what would we like to have? We would like to have some kind of correlation between our pushing the button and all the request calls that are done by our microservices. So every time we are pushing the button, there are log messages of the microservices, and it would be nice to have some kind of identifier that can be used to see the correlation between them. It's also nice to have some kind of identifier for each specific event. So when the breakfast service, for example, is called, this is a specific event. So we would like to have also an identifier that is unique for that service. But if it's calling another service, that service will have another identifier. This is where Sleuth can help us. It's a small library developed by Spring, and it uses Brave as interface, and it creates traces for you. So every time you're calling the first microservice, it will create a unique trace ID. And this trace ID will be passed to all the other services you are calling next. And each service will have its own span. The library can just be added like this, so you have a BOM dependency you need to add, and you also need to add the normal dependency. So this is what we are going to do for now. So I am picking my BOM that I use for all of my microservices, and I will add the BOM dependency. And I will also add the Sleuth dependency. And we have to reload, so it will take some time. Now we will push our button again. Of course, it's still taking 5 seconds because we didn't solve that yet. So, all right, and this is the interface of Kibana. So now we are going to check it out. So here are our log messages, and now we can see that we have these fields available, so the trace ID and the span ID and the parent span ID. And we can also, for example, filter on this specific trace ID. And now we can see that we have all log messages available for several services. So for example, for the breakfast service, but we also see the preference service and the machine service. So this trace ID is specific for our pushing of the toast button. And you can also see that the breakfast service, I will zoom in a bit. So the breakfast service will have a span ID, but this span ID will differ from the one of the preference service. And the preference service will also have a parent span ID. This means that the preference service is being called from the breakfast service, as these are the same IDs. So, well, here we have our microservice again. And now we have spans for each of those microservices generated each time we are pushing the toast button. And we also have the parent span IDs for the microservices that are being called next to another. And we also have the trace. And the trace is just one identifier that is being passed over all of those microservices each time we are pushing the button. We can also take a look at those identifiers in our logs because they are pushed to them. So here we have our trace ID. And here we have the spans and the parent ID. So now we can take a look at those identifiers, but still, well, we are not quite sure where our slow performance issue is. So we need another one, another library, and that will be Zipkin. Zipkin is a distributed tracing system. It consists of a Zipkin server and a Zipkin client. And Zipkin server has several other parts that are shown over there. And well, you can just start the Zipkin server, and you have to use a client to send your information to that Zipkin server. So the Zipkin client we are going to use is the one that Spring also provides for us. So by just adding this dependency, we can make use of the Zipkin client. The Zipkin server is just a GitHub project. It's also a Spring Boot application. You can also run it as a Docker image, or there are also cloud solutions available. Of course, when you're putting your Zipkin server in the cloud, you have to make sure that your client is sending the data to the cloud, and you have configuration to do so. But for now, I'm just running it locally. I will add the dependency for Zipkin. So that's this one. And we are going to start the Zipkin server. So I'm just using a Docker image. It'll take some time to be started. All right. And now we go back to our application. And let's push that button again. All right. And now we can go to the user interface of the Zipkin server. That's right here. And here we can see that we have a trace search bar. And you can select a specific service, for example, your breakfast service or another service, but we are not going to do that now. And you can select a specific name of the span. Well, you have several other options to look at. But for now, we are just going to push find traces, as we expect just one right here. So this one is actually indeed taking more than 5 seconds. So that's still what we already know. And we can click on this one. And now we can see a trace down of the services. So we have the breakfast service right here. And we can see that it's also calling the machine service and the preference service. And the machine service is calling a temperature and energy service. And we can also see how long each of those calls are taking. And well, we can see because the breakfast service is calling these ones, and this one is the last one being called, and it's taking 5 seconds. We can expect to have a problem right here. We can also click on it, then you can see also the client and the server timings. This can be important when there's something wrong, not in your service, but in the transmit time over it. So that's also important to take a look at. But for now, there's just a problem in the service, so we are going to fix this. So here it is. All right, let's just restart. And try again. Ah, I have to wait more. All right, so now our bread is toasted, so we solved the problem. So, and now we can also, of course, see the difference between the last call and this call. So now we can see that this one is taking less than 5 seconds. So with the help of the Zipkin client, which is sending information to our Zipkin server, and our Zipkin server, which provides a user interface, we could clearly see what the performance of our microservices are. And we could easily trace down problems that are here. So now we have our toasted bread, but we were creating breakfast. So we are going to our cucumber test. Well, we are using just a Selenium test for now, just an end-to-end test, and we are running a feature file. And well, something is going wrong. They are run automatically on the server, And, well, we have an error. So we want to know what is exactly going wrong, of course. And, well, maybe you can run it locally or maybe you cannot. But sometimes it can be quite hard to find out what the problem is. And, of course, you have your test results, but still it can be quite hard to figure it out. So we are, can look in our logs of the application, but you can imagine when you're running several tests, maybe at the same time, maybe after each other, it can also be quite hard to figure out which of those logs are related to the test you are looking at. So what we would like to have, because this test is not only calling our toast button, but also calling our coffee and frying of the egg and the bacon, we would like to have some kind of Uber trace or conversation ID. And well, Sluice is not providing this for us, so we have to create that ourselves. So we have to specify what we would like to have. Well, we would like to have some kind of possibility to put a request header as a client with a conversation ID to the application. And if it's not available, we would like to generate that conversation ID in the application that is being called. Also, we would like to ensure that the conversation ID is passed to all the services that are being called next. And, well, of course, it should be loggable, and it should also be searchable in Zipkin, so that we can easily take a look at it as well. And we would also like to have it in a response header so that the client can have it and can reuse it. In order to do this, we are going to extend the generic filter bean. This is just to get the HTTP request. And we are also making sure that it will be after the configuration of the actual tracing, so that we have a trace with a span already available. And, well, we have to use two extra properties of Sluice to make it work. The first of them is the propagation field. Well, you can add a propagation field, and this ensures that each microservice that is being called next will have also this property available. So the conversation ID will be passed to each of those microservices. But because this conversation ID is not passed to Zipkin, we also need to use tags. You can tag a span, but you cannot tag a trace, so they will not go to another microservice, but they will be passed to Zipkin. So that's why we are going to use that as well. All right. Let's go at this. So this is our filter that will extend the generic filter bean. And we are adding it next to the tracing filter we already have, so that there's a trace and a span available. And here we are getting the servlet request. And we try to get the conversation ID from the field propagation. If it's not available, we would like to generate it. So we will do that. And after that, we will set it as a propagation field. Also, because we would like to have it available in our Zipkin environment, we are also tagging the current span with the conversation ID. And we are also ensuring that it will be available in our logs. And then last, we would like to have the conversation ID available as a response header so that the client can reuse it for us. So let's restart our applications. And I will show the test we got. So here it's going wrong. The egg is taking too long. So we have a timeout. And if we are going to look over here, we can see that we have a conversation ID. And I'm going to use that conversation ID right here. So we will delete this. And now we see that we also have the conversation ID available right here. And let's do this. So now we have filtered our log messages with the conversation ID that we just set out of the test. And well, I'm going to look for an exception. And now we have the two log messages that have the exception. So probably the problem will be in a machine service, because that's the last service that has it. All right. So, well, here we have the problem. So let's restart it. And also, I want to show you that you can also find the error in Zipkin and find the conversation ID. So if I put the conversation ID right here. Here you can see that you have three spans. This means that one of them is the toasting of the bread, one of them is making the coffee, and one of them is the egg, and that is the one that is going wrong. So it has a red color because, well, there's something going wrong. And here you can also see that it stops right here. So you could also use Zipkin to find out what is going wrong. Although I prefer to use the logs just to search for errors. All right, and let's go back to the test again. So this now the test worked correctly. And still, of course, we have a conversation ID, so we can take a look at it, but we don't have to. So by adding the extra filter and using the propagation field and the tags, we could add valuable information to what we can look at. We can create correlations between several calls we are doing as a client, and could easily more easily find any issues in our logs and also in Zipkin. And if you make it available in your test reports, then you can also use it more easily. So with the help of the Elk Stack, Sluice, and Zipkin, we could create a more clear overview of our application calls. And with the help of Sluice, we created a more separation of the events that are actually happening by the traces and the spans. And well, with the help of Zipkin, it was more clear to see the performance of our services. And by adding some more information, we could even see more. So here, our logins and metrics went hand in hand, and we solved some problems. So thank you for your time. And if you have any questions, then just ask them. Yes?
I have one question. These context tags, how are they passed along? Can they be passed over GMS? So what performance are supported?
Yes, the question was the tax on which, well, implementations, for example, SOAP or GMS, if they can be passed over them. Well, Sleuth provides several integrations. It's they can, for example, do it over a web client or also asynchronous implementations. But it depends a bit. So some of them are implemented and some of them are not. So, yeah. So, any more? Yeah, oh, yes.
Mm-hmm. Which come in, and then it should result in some effect. You need to trace a problem in that effect. So how would you trace two control flows coming into your application, generating two unique IDs, mm-hmm. generating in one result?
Yeah. Hmm. So I'm not sure if I understand the question correctly. So what if you have two control flows at the same time and they are merged like into one?
Well, you have, I don't know, a game.
Yeah.
You have two users.
Yeah.
Into that game. Mm-hmm. When they are both logged in, something happens. Mm-hmm. Magic, right?
Yeah.
And then you have problems in your magic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Two different requests. Mm-hmm. And Sleuth would generate, I suppose, two unique IDs.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, then the visual tools would help you to look at each individual session separately.
Yeah.
But it wouldn't help you to see, well, I suppose it wouldn't help you to see the entire picture with two IDs.
No, it doesn't on default. It's just each separate. Sorry, I can try to repeat it. So when you have, for example, a game and you have two players and they are calling both the servers, and if they are combined in some way, well, they are just expected as separate calls. So they will have separate traces and also separate spans. But if there is some kind of mechanism needed to make that merge, then you need that to implement it yourself.
I see.
Yeah.
Then a kind of similar question. What if you have asynchronous processes, so the request has been served,
mm-hmm.
but then you have a piece of code that runs asynchronously as a background task or something?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, with a specific thread, you mean?
Yeah. Thread or send off to another service
afterwards. Yes, then it loses it if it's not correlated anymore to the call itself.
I see. Yeah.
Yeah. All right, well, thank you.